For the most part, game worlds are still better at information than soul. But if that's enough for you, it can go a long way.
This is where I live, and this is the view out my window. I can see bits and pieces of my world, but I never really get to see the big picture. I know how often my garbage gets removed. I'm told when to put it out, how to sort it, but that's all I know. I have no say in the matter. This is the transit station near my house. From this point, I have more access by public transit to my community than most people. I wonder what it would cost so that everybody could have service like this.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor. I was just discussing our bad traffic problem with a colleague.
Experimenting in real life costs a lot of money. It takes a lot of time. And what would the neighbors say? You can't really bulldoze things for fun. But suppose I were running things. What would I do? The first time I played SimCity, I took the game, I loaded it onto my machine, and I was up all night. I couldn't go to sleep. It was amazing to see this city that I built just start to grow. I was infatuated with the game, and the second night I sat down to play, and eventually I fell asleep, and when I woke up the next morning, my city had turned into this sprawling metropolis all by itself. And that's when I realized that somehow, even though it was just a computer simulation, it was really alive.
We see play and learning as the same thing, and that people are typically playing to learn, and playing is learning in a safe environment. And that's what simulation is all about, is doing in a safe environment where the consequences of the have your actions aren't nearly as bad as in real life. That's pretty. This is a satellite view of your city from very remote. And what you can do now is you can move in and zoom in onto the city and zoom all the way into the closest view. What we allow you to do is to remove layers so that you can remove the buildings, remove the surface, and now we can see underneath, we can remove the roads. Now we're just looking at the sewers and underground. If you notice all these cells, there's these little squares all throughout the city. Each cell has all of the data for the entire game, so each cell is being calculated independently. We're able to calculate all the cells so quickly that you think that it's all happening live all at once, and it'll develop on its own because the citizens will decide what to build. You're just zoning. We have a newspaper with SimCity, and this is how you get most of your feedback on what the citizens are thinking. Each newspaper is unique. It rewrites itself.
I wonder what happened to this building development. It would be nice to avoid making the same mistake twice.
For everything you do, there's something that'll happen. So for every action, there's some reaction. And we're not trying to say that it's right or wrong. For example, if you put in a power plant, you have your choice of coal, hydroelectric, oil, nuclear. Now, each of these have different consequences. Coal is a lot less expensive, but pollutes a whole lot more. We'll put in a nuclear plant.
You're a mighty good mayor. I've enough power lines and power plants to service your fine city. Splendid job, mayor. Just splendid.
All right, thank you.
The CD version of SimCity will have real actors in real locations playing out the results of sim decisions. Here, the game world could actually help the real world and whoever is running it.
Have you heard of black holes? That's what this city will become if you don't build more transmission lines immediately. You need a good shot from one of your very own 10 gigawatt lines. Maybe then...
The SimCity nuclear power plant right next door to our Sim Action News studio had a meltdown today.
little disaster help illuminate your mind? No sense crying over spilled milk. Just rebuild as quickly as possible.
It's not always intuitive what you would do to create a solution to a problem in a city. For example, during the LA riots, a lot of people called me and said, what do you do about this sort of a problem? You know about cities. They wanted me to send in the military or have more police.
Man, we're getting eaten alive out here. Recruit regular citizens, call in the militia, I don't care. This is war, and we're losing the battle.
My suggestion was you should put in pedestrian malls, more parks, and give grants to the businesses to make them nicer. And they were shocked. The truth of the matter is, if it's a nicer place to live and people have jobs, you get more tax revenue. If you have more land value, actually crime typically will go down. You have less money that you need to spend on your police services. And the exact opposite is true. So it's either a negative or a positive spiral. People typically are really fascinated with the destruction of a city early on. We have fires, floods, airplane crashes, tornadoes, earthquakes.
Do not panic! Earthquake! SimCity!
Once you put a lot of time into your building your city, then you have ownership of the city, and the last thing you want to see is a disaster. So for those people, we have a menu option, which is no disasters, and then there won't be any problems with your city. The most important element of SimCity is that of ownership. People take ownership of the city. When they talk about SimCity, they talk about it as something that's theirs. They say, my city, and they talk about their personal problems with the city. So they'll say, I have a crime problem in this part of town, or I'm trying to decide if I should zone this area for residential or commercial.
That's the thing of it. You don't own the real world. In fact, it often seems that you don't even have a voice. In the game world, nobody takes your power away.
We think that the people will be the most interesting aspect of the city, and we haven't had people in SimCity yet. But it's also the most complex part of designing a simulation. And not because people are the most complex thing to simulate, it's just that if there's one thing people know, it's other people. And that's our biggest challenge now.
We hate to think about those social aspects. There's certainly, for a wide variety of reasons, more people spending more time at home. We know that Nintendo is a tremendous asset for all those households where there are two working parents, and the millions of youngsters who return home each day from school to an empty household. And so we're positioned well for people to stay at home regardless of the reasons for that.
Everybody in the video game environment and the family entertainment environment are trying to create the feeling of being in the game and being a part of the game. I call it the sweaty palm syndrome, because you get in the game and all of a sudden you have this level of excitement that you really are flying this plane, and there is somebody attacking you, and your hands are grabbing the joystick. And it's my evaluation of a good game if my palms sweat within 15 seconds.
We have games that take well in excess of 100 hours to make your way through once, and then you can play it again on a totally different plane a second and third time.
What we're trying to do is create a virtual world that mirrors the real world. And the distinction between the real world and the simulated world is going to start falling out. And the reason is that as we build simulations of cities, eventually people will be programming in the data for real cities. This is a prototype of a dollhouse product that we're planning, where you'll be able to build and design your own home and then place it into SimCity. And so that if SimCity and Dollhouse are linked, it means you'll be able to go into any building in the city. And the idea is that there'll be a complete experience, and you can have many different ways of viewing the city.
Well, I think it creates the whole environment for the public to interact without going outside and confront some of the environments they may not want to confront at that period of time.
Box of my dinner sock, my breakfast sock, food sock.